Jennifer.
Hey, Richard.
How are you?
I'm awesome.
We've missed you terribly. You were somewhere off planet. Where'd you go?
I was in Napa with my girlfriends that I played basketball with in the seventh grade. So my girlfriends that I played basketball with from seventh grade throughout high school, they were actually more of the basketball players than I was. But we've all remained friends, and it was just so fun. It was one of the best trips, the best. We had such a blast. Everything went amazing.
Well, that's so cool, and not everybody gets a chance to travel right now, right?
Right, and we it was so lucky, and it was just, you know, all of us were vaccinated, so knock on wood, we, you know, right. it changes everything.
It does. Well, I know you're just about to ask me, why are we in a library today? Because
why are we in the Akashic Library?
Well, here's what I thought, because I haven't seen you in a couple of weeks, and what happens is, when I edit these things, when I edit our podcasts, occasionally somebody comes up, you know, that we glossed over. You'll say, so-and-so is here. And I'll say, great. Tell him to sit down. Let's focus on who we're talking to. And the only reason we do that is because you and I, we're like ping pong balls. We will bounce around the room if we need to or want to. But in particular, we did, I don't know if you remember, but we were...
Probably not.
Okay. So a couple of weeks ago, we were chatting away, and I'm going to start with the librarian. And this was a fella who you described as being short.
He looks like an elf, or he looks like a little, you know, not like an elf, but somebody that's short, like Yoda.
Okay. And so, I mean, and in terms of... We've talked to him before, and I've talked to him with different people. Let's just put it that way. And so I can't remember specifically who said what he looked like, but it was that idea of he doesn't, and you tell me what he looks like, but it was that he doesn't look old, but he feels old.
He feels like the oldest person, the first person here to me.
Wow.
And so, he comes in, you know, the coloring that I'm getting is green, like this iridescent green color. Uh-huh. So if he was just a light, he'd be all the colors, but green is like the more the
predominant color,
which is the heart center.
What would be a name that we could use to address him? I think he gave us a funny one once before, but today, you know, maybe it's different. It's fine, whatever, just so we can have a name.
He just said it's five. He just
five. Okay, five. Very good.
I'm like, is it zeal or something like that?
That's brilliant. Like that?
And he goes, so I'm like, five. Is that the fifth dimension that people are talking about? What is
well,
that?
Well, I'll tell you what. Let's just ask him some goofy questions to see. I mean, just to clarify what for people tuning in for the first time or the 100th time, this is a person that Jennifer and I have talked to before, that I personally have talked to via other people before, who is not somebody who incarnates and not somebody who has ever, let's ask him, have you ever been on the planet?
No.
And you also described yourself, and this is a self-description, not coming from me and not from Jennifer, but as somebody who was the librarian.
Mm-hmm.
And in,
can I share with you what he's showing me?
Please. So he knows what I'm going to ask, so go ahead.
So as you're talking, he's showing me, he's making me feel coincidences. Like he's the one that knows every meeting, everything that happens here and elsewhere. And so it's like everything crisscrosses. I can't explain it. It's like the lights. So like us meeting each other, like everything, making all these things happen.
What seems like coincidence, he's showing you his actual blueprints.
Correct.
Like translucent blueprints. We've talked about this before. People talked about it in terms of deja vu. We've talked about that before. If you lay down these blueprints on top of each other where they intersect, that's the feeling of it.
Time feels compressed to me. It just goes whoop.
So let me ask.
present, future.
So let's ask him some questions. Somebody with great, profound knowledge. Why the color green?
He said because Yoda was king. He's just showing me Yoda. Yoda looks a little greenish. Little pilot.
Is that related to the healing frequency?
Yes.
Okay. And so in essence, you're somebody who represents healing. Is that correct?
Yes.
And so how do people tap into you? Here we are. We're having a conversation with you.
We heal through each other. The more humanity that we help, the more it comes, we get healed. We help heal through each other.
So, in other words, if I help somebody heal, I'm also helping somebody else heal. Is that what you mean?
Like an ancestry line. He's just showing me like if I, essentially each time we come here, we have a chance to heal ourselves through all time and space.
So I see, you're talking about the overall arc of all of our lifetimes.
Bingo.
And so something that happened.
He just showed me the baton being passed. Like each lifetime we're healing a part of ourselves elsewhere as well.
We've talked about this before. It's a little bit hard for humans to conceptualize. Not that I'm not one of them, but that idea of when you step outside of time and you see all of your lifetimes as a sort of 3D chess game, you can see how an illness in the 1500s has affected your journey to become a doctor in this lifetime or to heal yourself. And so it's like they all are part of the same journey or path.
Yeah, he showed me he just showed me a broken bone, like breaking your arm. You break yourself to get stronger. Like if you, he just showed me, because you know how if you break your arm, sometimes it heals stronger because it heals itself from, it's no different than like with your skin. Like if you scrape your skin, it knows to heal itself, right?
Mm-hmm. Comes back stronger.
Yeah, you become stronger.
So from your perspective, sir, of the planet, how can we help each other heal the planet?
Thank you. By healing ourselves. And in return, that helps heal others. Like he's saying it just like what I said before, but about healing other people, which helps heal ourselves. But he shows me that theory of putting on the mask first. You're more apt to help heal others when you are healed.
I see. Can I ask you some questions about your journey and path?
Yes.
He
gave you the questions.
He gave it in advance. I guess I might have asked this before, but do you represent a person who is from another realm? Let me ask it, put it that way. That your journey and path, or are you of this realm?
He's the same person in all the realms, he says.
Okay, and so if I was in another realm, let's say, not this universe, and I went to the library, would I run into you again, some version of you?
You just showed me you'd run into yourself, like a translucent version of yourself. Hold on. So
my consciousness, let's say.
Bingo.
Well, we had a very unusual conversation with you.
And this is another mind-bending thing. I'm like, are you God? Are you what God represents? Are you, because
yours.
The coincidences and everybody, all the lights meeting up and being almost like being in charge, but not being in charge. It's a system, thank you, that like your skin already knows to heal itself. That's how this universe works, he's saying. It's similar to that. I'm not in charge, but I'm allowing and watch. He's like, I don't allow. Hold on.
I love when he argues with you.
Yeah, he's like, I'm observing.
Observing, participating, being almost like a guide who doesn't interfere.
Bingo.
And so let's talk to, about the Akashic Library, because people use this word, and I know I had this conversation with you. I said, is there a better word? You said, look, it took this long for people to use the word. Just use the word. Akashic just means etheric or energetic or invisible. It's not that it's some special spiritual thing or related to a religion. And each book of who we are, each lifetime of who we are, let's just call it that, is contained in these we call them books. We see them as books. Some people see them as lights.
String. He's showing me tethering, like string theory.
Like it's each one connected to each other. Is right. that right? But let me ask you, string theory, let's focus on that for a second. Is that how things are stored? Is the vibrating strings of string theory how information is retained?
He showed me like a mirror. Like, you know how if you look like at those carnival mirrors where you know, you're in a place with a bunch of mirrors,
yeah.
you're being shown all the way. He was giving me the impression that it's yourself here, but it's also yourself in all these other dimensions.
Okay, well, that would be a question about multiverses, but I, from what I understand, what we've
talked. Sorry, maybe I didn't understand the question.
No, that is an interesting observation, because I'm just trying to get at, I'm not trying to understand string theory or about multiverse theory, but I'm really asking is these books that mm-hmm. represent our lifetimes. And I think you described them once before as balls of light, like tennis balls of light. And if we opened up that tennis ball of light, that would have all the emotions, all the things that happened in a previous lifetime.
Right.
Something like that. And the way they're stored, it depends on the person. They see them as tennis balls. They see them as books. They see them as holographic imagery, sometimes as movies, right. when they access this. So why the different constructs? Why not just one construct? Why is it that people observe things completely different? I mean, there's no two Akashic Library descriptions that match, other than the word.
There's only one.
But why do we see them differently? Sorry.
It's based upon our experience.
Over all of our lifetimes, not just this life.
Correct.
We had a weird conversation with you about James Dean. There was a moment when Jennifer and I were talking to you, and you sort of, as an aside, said, oh, that information about James Dean is accurate. But yes, that is correct. We were talking to him about this particular, about James Dean and how James Dean had already returned. Because we were talking to James Dean and we said, what's the story? When are you coming back? And he said, I'm already back. And he named this actor who remains nameless for personal reasons, who's very successful and has had a career and a life and married and kids and been on the whole nine yards. And I've reached out to him and I confirmed with him that his whole life, people had come up to him and said, you know, you're the reincarnation of James Dean. He was always like, what? And then he's got many things that have happened in his lifetime that echo that. But he doesn't want to address it. And we have to respect that. So
I'm glad that you told me about it. I forgot about that.
No. But the reason I wanted to address it with him is mm-hmm. because in this world of coincidence, I've had a number of things that seem coincidental. For example, when I was talking to you, had said you had met, I'd asked you, had you met me before?
Okay.
Five. And your answer was what? Or is what?
Yeah. It's yes, of course.
But, and he was referring to a session.
He's referring to, so I just saw you going to a classroom. And there's something with like your dream state, you're in there all the time, it feels like.
So I'm yes. And of course he's the one who insisted we have a continue this conversation. But my point is there was a question that was asked in a session I was filming. I didn't ask the question, but I was there filming it. And the question was, what or who is God? And the answer was, God is beyond the capacity of the human brain to comprehend. However, if you open your heart to everyone and all things, you can experience God.
Correct.
And our friend Five referred to that conversation saying, I had met Rich. We were not communicating, but he was there when I was talking to somebody else. Is that what you were referring to?
Yeah. I have no idea what that means. But
so you see, that's mind bending to me because I know what that means. I was literally in a room listening to, you know, while I was filming this question. So let's talk about that for a second, just to give Jennifer an idea of what I mean. This idea that God is not a person per se, and your point was
it's beyond the capacity for our little brain.
Human brains. Well, because there's so many multiple layers.
It's like, and even alien brains, but yes.
Okay. That concept is too broad. However, and you said this very succinctly, you can experience God, which is like, if you want to go skydiving, you can talk about it forever, but until you jump out of the plane, I wouldn't do that. So, but you've experienced it, so you know what that means. Mm-hmm. When he said you can experience God by opening your heart to everyone and all things. So let me ask you to clarify that, because I didn't get a chance then. What do you mean by opening your heart to all things?
I want to feel like it's all parts of you elsewhere. So if you see the beauty of a tree, or you understand how it creates oxygen, the love that you have for a tree might be heightened. But if you think it's just a tree and you cut it down for wood,
your heart's not open to it.
Your heart's not open to it.
And this also goes to this
painful to watch a tree go down.
This also relates to the concept of love. You mentioned the word love. And
this is interesting because through a client, something came through about Jesus. You know, people are like, what? But Jesus has no enemies. And the feeling that I got from that was, he has no enemies because he loved everything and everyone. He loved all things, right?
So opened his heart to everyone and all things.
Yeah, he had no enemies.
Yeah, but I just want to then go one step further, which is love, mm-hmm. the term that we use, unconditional love. Is that what consciousness is? Is that the fabric of the universe, and that's why we can open our heart to things? Because
it's the springboard to it, yes.
It's the springboard to it.
Because there's things that you love that, okay, thank you. There's things that you love, but you don't understand why. You can love a car, but not understand why. You can love a ladybug and not understand why. You know, you're not taught to, love comes from the inside, as we all know, it's innate. And the more that you love everything, the more that you care for everything, the less hostile you are towards yourself and others, of course. You can't see love, but it's there.
Is it because you're recognizing the frequency of all things?
You're recognizing your higher self in all things. So which is not a hierarchy. So you're recognizing a higher being or your higher self, which is made up of love. It's like you get driplets of that. So the more that you love, the more that you open, your heart is open, the more that is given to you, and the more that you want, if you love yourself, you're gonna love the planet and try to take care of the planet.
So it goes in that circle.
Besides, it's the best. Well, it's interesting. Hold on. He's not a he. He's like, I would be called they. Like, he doesn't identify.
Okay. Yeah. Calling him a guy is not appropriate. He's five. Literally five.
Five. He just thinks that's funny.
It is funny.
There's more reasons for that. That's interesting.
The reasons? What's it? What is the other part of five? Is he talking about a hand? Is he talking about five?
I turn 50 this year. and he showed me zero, and then he showed me putting a comma, and then it's infinite how many years old that is. So that's why he's just like five.
Five. Wow. The five dude. High five. I guess we're talking to him when everybody says that. Hey. High
five.
Five. He's funny.
He is funny. Not he, but five is funny.
Five is funny.
He's just like, think about the flowers blooming. Think about how much, if you don't discriminate, and that's what he, that's the reason for him saying that he would be called they. Five, I mean, you become more androgynous, loving everything around you.
Because your heart is open to everything.
Heart is open to everything.
So five, let me ask you.
People, he says that's the pulse of life. He goes, if your heart stops, your heart stops. Right?
But how can you, in just a practical way, how do we open our hearts? Because it's a physical thing of action as opposed to just sitting back and accepting.
Right.
I mean, it's both, obviously.
What it makes me feel like is being vulnerable. Like, you have to open your mind to it. You have to open your mind to the possibilities of love. It's not just from here. Bless you. Love
bless
is
you.
Not just from here. Love can be everywhere. Love is everywhere. So if you had like a scoop, like where you could just scoop up love, it's the reflection you see in everything around you.
So opening your heart to everyone and all things as a definition of what or who God is a way of realizing that God is within everything, or love is within everything, or consciousness is within everything.
That's why I like being five. God has always been, but God is goddess. God is
goddess, God. Right? Exactly.
Everything.
Well, is everything, right? Is flea, is... Now, you can help us with this one. Five.
It's the power source that runs humanity.
Wow. It's the power, and okay, it's the power source that runs humanity and the universe, I would assume. Everything.
It is the universe.
Okay.
It's everything.
So,
which love is everything.
So I'm sure you put this into my head as well. We glossed over somebody else 2 weeks ago. Yeah. My fault. Jennifer, we were talking to Audrey Hepburn, who mm-hmm. showed up willy-nilly and said a lot of things that I didn't know about her, and looked up, and they all turned out to be true, as happens to us.
Really?
Yeah.
I love that. I don't
know. I do. Yeah, I do too. It's mind-bending. However, at some point you said, oh, that actor who is a mafia guy showed up.
Al Capone, but what's his name?
Not Al Capone. He never played.
No, I know, but...
Begins with a B. Last name begins with a B. Brando.
Brando, yes.
Okay.
Brando.
Brando. So I'm later sure. on, I mean, afterwards, after the session, I went, oh my gosh, I just totally dissed Marlon Brando. And for the audience, look, we've talked about this incessantly. There is no hierarchy. On the flip side, talking to somebody on the other side, the reason we can talk to Brando is because Luana, who's here and orchestrated this, you know, knew Brando and knew a lot of people who were friends with him. So that's doesn't bother us at all, the fact that he might show up. However, when we did talk to him, he was very shy the initial time. It was like pulling teeth. He sat in the back of the class. He hasn't really expressed himself in any sort of vociferous way. And now Audrey shows up, and suddenly he's in the room. So I wanted to now turn the spotlight over to you, sir, which is, what did you want to say? Because you showed up. I know why. I know what your relationship is with Audrey.
Well, he just said, he goes, I love Audrey. I'm like, was she there for you? And he goes, she was there for someone I deeply loved. And she's also somebody I'm still learning from.
Interesting. And so you came forward. Is that what you wanted to say? That you're still learning from her? Or what's your observation of her over there?
We're all still learning. now we're learning about you. Now we're learning about, or, you know, now it's a whole different, just like, it's like somebody taking an astronomy class, only everybody over there, excuse me, is taking an earthly class.
That's a brilliant way to put it. Yeah. So, but let's just talk about this. Learning about us. You would assume, anyway, you'd think that once you cross over, you'd be like, oh, yeah, I understand everything now. But you're saying that's not the case. It's, we learn. We're always learning.
Always learning. I'm like, they have a different job now, which is helping out coincidences here.
Right.
Let's manifest things here.
Well, and let's talk a little bit about your journey, sir, because I know we asked you before, who was there to greet you when you crossed over, but what was your experience like crossing over? Was it what you expected, or?
It was not what I expected, but I love seeing my family that has passed. You know, I feel like his dad was a huge influence on him somehow. I don't know, but that's what he's showing me.
True.
And I think I feel like his mother was still alive when he passed. I'm not sure.
I don't know. I do know we had a conversation about your will.
Right. And then Aretha Franklin showed up for her will.
Like, for her will. We talked to her about her will. But not to get into the particulars and details of Marlon's will, which is in the book. And I don't want to get into it because
Jack Nicholson, and he's showing me a chair, but that's something else.
That's correct. That is correct. The chair from Marlon's house wound up in Jack's house. And out of that chair fell a copy of Marlon's will.
Really?
And, okay. Yeah. Okay. And
you know, I don't remember those things. He just showed me a chair, Jack Nicholson, and a hat, and something that was in the chair.
That's correct. And so Jack sent it on to the attorney to say, you know, I don't know why this copy of this will is here. You know, did Jack put it, or did Marlon put it there? Et cetera, et cetera. And you and I discussed this at some point, but it was that there was something wrong with the actual signature. Because at the time when he supposedly signed it, he was too ill to sign the will. And so I won't get into that because it's none of my business. It is ancient history, let's put it that way. But I did want to at least turn the spotlight over to you, sir, because certainly you had a profound effect on so many people, so many lives. And the fact that, so I'll tell Jennifer that the story goes, he went out with Audrey on a date early on. They were both at their start of their careers and they didn't say anything to each other, or they met somewhere and he was shy about talking to her because he was such a fan, and she thought he was being indifferent or didn't care about her. And so he heard about that years later and wrote her a letter apologizing and explaining. Now, was that accurate, Marlon? What happened?
Absolutely.
And so when you ran into her on the flip side, what was your conversation with her?
I'm still watching her. I'm still inept in talking to her.
Sweet.
You know, it's different because our souls see each other.
Right. You know? Well, let's ask about that. When you see her, are you looking at her space into like a specific age? Are you looking at her for all of her lifetimes, or how does that work?
We go back into our memories. They can instantly go back into their memories of when they first met, and they're just sharing with me like the loud noises, how I feel like the sense of popcorn. I don't know why. Like they're able to go back into our cost. They're showing me the library, going back into that. I know that wasn't your question. But
it's all right. No, please. They're wrapping it up better than I can.
We get to go play. We get to go back into that place in time. And instead of not knowing each other, we know all of each other. But we get to experience it again differently from the viewpoint of what we know now. So my dad showed me Dancing with Me. Now, knowing what I know now, and dancing with him, going back into that memory, how much more would I love my dad versus, you know, being nervous or whatever it is, you get to be fully present with that person, knowing what that person's been through or knowing what's going to happen in the future, being able to go back in time. It's fascinating.
Wow. That's beautiful and brilliant. Yeah. So five, excuse me, Marlon, five's here and you know, he's a bigger, better deal. We know there's no hierarchy, but how many people do you know named five? Okay. So five, Jennifer, are you okay? I'm sorry. I like to talk to her dad because her dad always underlines what we're talking about. And I was going to ask you, Jim, about this today, because you're the first person who walked us into a library and pulled a book out. For those who are fans of Backstage Past the Flip Side, he pulled a book out and showed Jennifer an event, because I asked, that happened so many years ago that she wasn't aware of it. And I asked him, when did you first realize your daughter was a little goofy? Yeah. And he reminded her of when she was a little girl and she said, Grandpa is in California and he needs us to move there and take care of him.
And that's exactly what happened.
That's why we are here today.
I know. I'm sorry.
That's all right. No, no. We love your dad. And, you know, anytime he stops by, Jim.
I miss him so much.
All right. Well, Jim, you're here. Let's ask Jim, what's your impression of five, Jim?
Five is the light that people are attracted to. He's showing me like the candles being lit and these little lights in the sky. He's laughing about the whole, the five.
We have to meet six and four.
Five is our innate goodness inside. So five is what we reflect as, like, it's our following our intuition, our loves, our passions. Five is like following a yellow brick road, you know.
Following our intuitions and passions. And so we've asked him about this, five, which was, are you responsible for those coincidences or are you just orchestrating them? I guess that's the same as responsible, or just letting people or helping them to realize that we're all connected.
Helping them to open up to the possibilities that there's infinite possibilities and infinite insurmountable amounts of knowledge and wealth that we can get from the other side. And we can, like what we're doing, they're showing we're transferring energy back and forth.
So what's your impression, five, of what we're doing? What's your opinion?
It's an opening that helps people get into their heart.
And the specific way for them to do that, or helpful way?
Listen to our podcast.
Listen to our, oh my gosh, we're getting a review from five on the flip side. Yeah. Tune in every week, says five.
And I have to go right
now. I know you do. Five, thank you so much for showing up. Marlon, I appreciate it. Jim, Audrey, all of you. Luana, we didn't even barely say hello, but we love you madly. We appreciate it, and we will catch you either later on the flip side today or next week.
All right.
Love you.
Okay. Love you.